I want to thank you all for coming this afternoon. We are delighted to welcome for this afternoon Christopher Brown and Megan Atherton. We are so pleased to have this opportunity to talk about the history of our art community in relationship to the Richmond Art Center, to our institutions of higher learning, our art schools and art departments and universities. We are especially pleased that we will be able to have a video of this, and we are grateful to Lia Levy of the J. DeFeo Trust, which is now the J. DeFeo Foundation. And as further testimony to the depth of this community, to have an artist who was involved with the Richmond Art Center, who showed here over the years, and who really made a mark with her legacy in establishing a foundation that would support artists of the future and programs like this. So thank you very much for coming and joining us today. So, the first thing, if you didn't know, Chris has been teaching in the Bay Area for a long time. He has taught at UC Berkeley for many years, where he was head of art practice. He moved to California College of the Arts, CCA, and Megan was a student of his. Mm-hmm. And Megan has now gone on herself as an artist to exhibit, and she's teaching at Humboldt State in Eureka. And I think there are a lot of questions that I have, and probably you'll have too, so we'll open it up to questions from the audience also. But my first question is really directed at Megan, and it's, how did you decide where you would go to study, and what were you after, what were you looking at, and what were some of the things that really influenced your decision?
Oh yeah, okay, so I applied to many schools in the California area. That was primarily where I wanted to stay. I didn't want to go to the East Coast or anywhere. So I kind of focused on the Bay Area because my parents live in Woodland right over near Davis, and kind of wanted to be somewhat in the vicinity of them. So that was kind of the overarching first decision. And then I applied to several schools in the Bay Area, and I didn't get in anywhere. And then I applied again, and I didn't get in anywhere. And then I applied, and I took a year off of applying. And then I applied for the third time around after spending the previous year building a body of work that I felt was more cohesive than the work that I was applying with before. That the first two times I was applying with work that I had primarily done in undergrad, and maybe it wasn't totally a cohesive body of work. So I spent that third year making more work that I felt kind of had a stronger core and more unification. And then I applied again, and I got into a few places, California College of the Arts, and where else? SF State, I think. There's somewhere else, too. So I went to both of those, their MFA openings for the graduating MFA classes, and CCA really blew me away. And the faculty that were there that I met during that opening, I think I met Chris at that time, or maybe it was right after that time, and spoke with Chris, and Linda Geary also was somebody that I met at that point, and they won me over just with how enthusiastic they were about the potential that I would go there. And the work, the quality of the work that was shown at California College of the Arts for their MFA show was above and beyond anything that I had seen anywhere else. And that was really what sealed the deal for me for going there, was thinking about how my work could grow in that environment with these people that I met. And I think that was it.
Well, perseverance, that's amazing to actually develop your own program and really be self-directed and develop work independently. That's quite extraordinary to have accomplished that on your own. Chris, it's been a while since you made those kinds of decisions,
yeah.
But you made a huge change in terms of geography when you chose to come to the West Coast and study. Could you talk a little bit about what drew you to California and...
Well, I came to California in 1973 to go to UC Davis. I had gone to undergraduate school at the University of Illinois. And as one of the good things about Illinois when I was there, they had a very good art program, very rigorous academic, traditional kind of art program, a lot of drawing, a lot of different classes we had to take all day long. But one of the things that was really good about it was that they had a very good visiting artist program. So when I was a junior and a senior, I would ask a lot of the visiting artists that would come through about graduate schools. And many of them said, well, the first thing you have to do is get out of the Midwest and get to one of the coasts, because that's where things are much more interesting. He says, this is a good school to be at for undergraduate school, but you, one of the things you want to do when you go to graduate school is to change the milieu that you're in, learn new things, be exposed to new ideas. And so at that time, the early 1970s, late 1960s, California was everything. So that's where I wanted to come. I didn't even think about going to the East Coast. And Davis at that time was probably the most well-known school. Davis and Yale. Yale on the East Coast, everybody said. Yale on the East Coast, Davis on the West Coast. So those are the two best art schools. Those things change because faculty change. But at that time, Davis had a very well-known faculty. So that's where I applied. I remember I too sent out six applications. And one by one, they came back, and I was rejected by every school that I applied to. And then finally, Davis came through, and I was accepted. And I thought, oh, I was so relieved. You know, and then thrilled, of course, to be able to go there. And then really disappointed to get there and see that it looked just like Illinois. Completely flat and agricultural. I thought I was coming to California. But oh, no.
So. But did the people look different?
They look the same people, but it was good. It was a good place. Mm-hmm. It was kind of the opposite of undergraduate school. It was very independent. They gave us these kind of big, nice studios, and they didn't really say anything. And we only had one class a week. That was it. When you went to a seminar and you drank beer and for 3 hours, one night a week. That was the only class we had. The rest was just independent studies, and you were just told to work.
So when you went into the classroom the first time, into the studio the first time, as the instructor. And you'd had that experience of essentially a couple of years of working independently, and how did you approach teaching coming from that?
As a completely lost person, I think. You know, when you start teaching, you teach kind of the way you were taught. Mm-hmm. You know, you just remember things that you were taught in certain classes, and you just use those until you use them up. Then you have to start thinking of new things. So, but you don't really have a plan or a program, you know. And it took me a few years to figure out sort of how to structure, what I believed, what I thought, and then how to structure a way of teaching that to students. I'm just starting to get that down now. Now that I've retired, I've got some good ideas. But it took a long time, you know, and it's trial and error. And semester after semester, you'd find some things work. It's like being a comedian, you know. I mean, it works with this crowd, then the next crowd it doesn't work with. You're thinking, what happened? That was so good last semester. I don't know, you just make your way gradually, you know. But the great thing about teaching is that as a fledgling teacher, you just learn so much. That's the wonderful thing about it. You learn way more than you're teaching. And for me, it was just a life raft as an artist to be able to go there and steal ideas from students. And you know, I mean, it's so good in all these great ways. I mean, that is true. You do see your students doing things and you go, oh, that could be really useful. but you also you realize many things, like, that, just like with Megan saying, that perseverance is everything. And that the kids that just work harder, their work is better. And that enthusiasm is so important. And fearlessness is so important. The kids that are enthusiastic do better work. Their work is livelier and more interesting. All these kinds of lessons. And the kids who are kind of fearless, they teach you as a teacher and as an artist. You go back to your student and they're like, I'm going to be like that student. I'm going to be fearless. You know, and you have to learn that. I mean, this is the, one of the problems with school is intimidating. You know, you're always told what you do wrong, and it tamps you down, and you have to kind of unlearn that. And that's, I think, your main job as an artist after you get out of school, is to unlearn all the crap you were taught.
Okay. <Yeah. laughs> So, Megan, you've been out of school all of 2 years?
Yep.
And now you're in that position of teaching. So were there things, what kinds of things did you pull out from that whole sort of bag of tricks to take in, and how did you repurpose things, and how did you approach things freshly in new ways?
Oh man, so I've been teaching, I guess, 4 semesters total, or this is my 4th semester with summer school. Every summer I've been teaching summer school. So, and at different institutions. I got a teaching fellowship out of California College of the Arts, where I taught a painting 1 class that first fall semester out of grad school. And at that point I was working with Chris also, and he was incredibly helpful. Like, I'd go to him and tell him things that happened, and he would be like, okay, that's okay, this is what you can do with that. And then I got a teaching, a sabbatical replacement at Humboldt State University, and so I moved up there and did that teaching painting, and then I moved into other departments, the drawing department there, and then also at College of the Redwoods, I'm teaching drawing there also. So it's been an incredible learning experience. Like, there, you know, going into that first class at California College of the Arts, you know, I prepped all summer. I made my syllabus, and I did everything that I thought would be the best that I could do in terms of what to teach these students, and a lot of it was coming out of things that I had learned in undergraduate and grad school. You know, grad school, you don't get a lot of technical stuff, but beginning painting or painting one, that's pretty technical. So, you know, and that I felt fairly comfortable in the technical realm. So I was like, okay, I can do that technical stuff. Taking all that stuff and kind of putting it together in a way that I thought was going to lay out these techniques for them in a way that they would be interested in, you know, getting their own imagery and ideas in there also, because these, you know, beginning students are all about, like, I want to get all my ideas out there, but it's like a little bit later you can get all your ideas out there once you get how you can get those ideas across with the formal elements of how to manipulate paint so that you can communicate with that paint, so that language of painting can come across with whatever you want to say. But first you need to learn how to use that language of painting. So I don't know, like, necessarily how fresh I came at it. Like, I think it was trying to kind of conglomerate all the things that I've learned and put it into a linear space for these students so that they could have projects. And then, you know, it's been a learning experience the last 4 semesters, every semester kind of taking something out of the last semester, out of the last class, even like yesterday, what am I going to do next week, a little bit different. And it's always just a huge learning experience. And yeah, getting the students to be doing things that they're really excited about and in different new ways that they didn't know was possible, but, you know, learning things in the class, they kind of get going on their own tangents, and that's when it's really exciting to see, you know, how they can take these skills that I'm teaching them and make them their own. It's a trip. It's a trip teaching, and it's great. I'm always learning about. I feel like I go in and I tell the students, okay, this is how you can do this thing, and this is how it'll be really efficient to do it that way, and you can be really free in this way and whatnot. And then I go back to my studio and I'm like, I'm not doing anything that I just said. And should I do that? And so I'm like adjusting based on what I'm telling my students to do. Okay, and then I try and I'm like, oh, it is better to do it that way. Like, it's like conceptually it works better telling them that, but then actually applying it's really hard. I don't know, it's a kind of a sticky thing, but it's, you know, it's an ongoing learning experience, and we'll see what happens next week.
you had a charming anecdote of being in the studio with Chris and seeing him in front of his painting, a green painting, and that just seeing The way colors were playing off of each other and vibrating, it set you off in a whole direction with your painting and stimulated a whole series of work and working, you know, chromatically driven. And so I'm wondering, Chris, that this way in which things come to us sometimes unexpectedly in just ordinary circumstance that one wouldn't, you know, imagined as being stimulating to a whole new body of work. Where and how do you draw things, and how do things come to you?
That's a good question. But it's an important question, I think, for every artist. The first thing that I would say is an answer that I wouldn't have given when I was younger. But I know it's really true for me, that most of my ideas are based in nature. Most of my ideas come from seeing the world. And when I say ideas, it sounds like it's something that I'm thinking. That's almost never true. My ideas are visual ideas. They're things that I see. And I'm really, and I have always been, the more older I get, the more I realize that I've been this way from the time I was 3, 4, 5. I have visual memories from that age. Things that I remember around our house, the neighborhood that I lived in, I can still remember very specific visual memories from that. And they still are part of the things that I paint about. When I say in nature, I mean really the nature of the whole world, anything in the world that's visual. The trees across the street from where I grew up, having to mow the lawn in stripes influenced me. You know, you mow back and forth. And I love the way the green would change color when you would mow it, you know? Things like that influenced me as a painter. I like the way the stripes of the grass, for example, were similar to the clavard of the house. And I thought, oh, the whole world here is kind of organized in stripes. And that was an interesting idea to me. And I recognized it as a seven-year-old when my dad taught me how to mow the yard. I thought, oh, that's an interesting idea. Well, that's a part of my work now, you know. So things like that. I just derive things from nature all the time. I love just seeing the world, and the older I get, the more I really love it and appreciate it even more. So I love going out, and my girlfriend Anna and I just went to Maine. We were in Maine a week ago, and I sort of feel like I need those necessary breaks to get out of the urban environment and go see the natural world. Mm-hmm. But I'm influenced by both, the natural world and the urban world, and I sort of need both, need time in both. To help my painting grow, remind me who I am, what I love. Pretty simple.
I think it's a sign of being a really well-integrated human being. You know,
I think it's what painters do. You know, I mean, it's what I love about painting. I have to say, I consider myself a painter. I'm not really an artist. I mean, the difference for me is that in the modern world, we know what modern art is, and modern art is so idea-driven, conceptual art and performance art and all these things, and painting these days is so driven by conceptual ideas, political ideas, sociological ideas, ideas about content, and to me, this is sort of a tragedy. I mean, I'm not really interested in very much contemporary art for that reason. I'm interested in looking. And the most beautiful painting to me is always about just seeing the world, seeing the same old, ordinary, banal, stupid things. You know, you think about the history of painting, it's divided into three categories: still life, landscape, and portraiture, right? And so those are still the sort of the three basic categories. And we have those categories for a reason. The idea is that you don't paint spectacular, dramatic things. The world's not made of just spectacular, dramatic things. The world is made of a lot of, well, there are a lot of amazing places like the Grand Canyon and these mountains and all that. But for most of us in our quotidian lives, our lives are made up of things we see over and over and over, right? The thing is to see them in a way that's new and unique, and that's what painting is about, is trying to take the ordinary and make something exceptional out of it by the way you describe it. It's the same thing that writing does verbally. It just takes ordinary life and makes something interesting of it.
I would posit that there was a fourth category, and that was historical painting, which had a really important place in this hierarchy for a long time, and then with modern art, sort of lost its position. But maybe in some ways, the historical painting has been replaced by a lot of multimedia in contemporary terms, and is doing what you were saying in terms of a sociological and politically driven impulse to really document and map out and somehow have it definitely has a different agenda, but is suited to new forms, digital, electronic, and other things. Megan, you've just had a big change. So you've left the Bay Area and you've gone into what is really also nature in Eureka. So what kinds of changes have you seen in your work from that kind of a geographical change?
Yeah, I think I am, and I think this is sort of, there was a change in my work that happened once I started teaching and coming out of grad school, where I felt really pressured to get in all those ideas into the paintings, and they're there, and in grad school I really was interested in how to get these any ideas that I was having out in the formal language with the formal elements of painting, space and color and shapes and composition and those things. And I think out of that, I moved up to Humboldt County, where it's, very, very nature driven, and there's not a lot of struggle, like when you're in the Bay Area, when I was in the Bay Area, I felt it was like, I was always running around. It was always just like trying to get from point A to point B to do this, do that, there was no downtime. It was like hustling all the time. And up there, it's so mellow. Like, there's like no traffic. It's just like the bee's knees. I'm, go to point A to point B. It takes me 15 minutes max, and I have all this time to kind of be in nature and be looking at these things, color and composition, and how I kind of organize the world in those terms. And so I think my work has become, and I will also say that I've been, I don't think I've been really prolific in how much painting I've been doing since moving up there, because teaching is very time consuming, especially the last couple of years. It's like I'm always doing that, and then sometimes I paint. It's like, oh great, I can paint. But I think I'm much more interested in the, in these, how things look and how I can organize these things on a canvas and how the interaction of color happens, and how that could mean something else. That could be the idea. That could be, these paintings can be all about perception and my perceptual things that are going on with my hand in front of this green canvas that's turning fluorescent pink, and then I start thinking about the subjects that I'm painting and how really the subjects can be about perception also, like a green grassy lawn. You don't even see those that often anymore because of the drought all the time. So like we kind of think about that as being the idyllic, like green grassy lawn. Yeah, that's like summertime and it's the middle class and it's, the suburbs and but that doesn't happen really. But what is my perception of like the ideal life, and really it doesn't exist, I guess, or it's, where does it exist? I don't know. But I think it's like I'm more interested in these formal things, and that's a lot of what I talk to the students about too. And I think in teaching the formal stuff, I've gotten way more interested in that a painting is about paint, and it's about composition, and it's about shapes, and it's less about the subject that I'm painting. It's more about how I'm painting it. And I think that's been a big change moving up there, and it goes hand in hand with teaching. And everything's green up there. Well, not everything. There are brown lawns. There are actually almost all the lawns are brown. There's a few that are like spray painted. Like there's this, I don't know, that happens down here too, but it's like really weird. But so it's, I think I'm definitely influenced by the pace of life up there, maybe more than being in the sticks or in the city, maybe or maybe not. Maybe I'm influenced by the green also. And
thank you, MC.
One of the things that some might not know here is that you had a period of writing art criticism, and Chris was awarded. the NEA acknowledged him as an art critic, and the questions that come to mind are having that position, that critical view of art, how that continues to reverberate in an approach to your own work, your students' work, how that might inform what you're able to pass on to them, and really the rigor of that position. Could you talk about that a little bit?
It's a big subject. Yeah. Let's see. Well, I think every artist is a critic in some way. You know, that's part of a fundamental part of trying to be a painter. Because you've got to figure out what you're going to do and why you're going to do it. You know, so you, as I was talking about teaching, it's related to criticism in the sense that as you grow as an artist, you find yourself sorting through a whole set of possible values, trying to figure out what it is you believed. And the reason that I wrote was to help clarify my own ideas about what I did think. I'd go out to shows and just ask myself, well, what do I think is the best thing in this show? What do I think is the best show that I saw today? What am I most interested in? Why? What makes it more interesting than something else? What are your basis for, what basis do you have to criticize anything? Is it just based on personal preference, or do you have transcendent values by which you can sort of judge all things? And you judge paintings in a way that's similar to the way you judge sculpture? Yes and no, those things are different. But in any case, I started to figure out sort of what my prejudices were through writing. I wrote for about 6 or 7 years. And it was good. It was a very good discipline. It was hard. Both writing and painting are both very difficult, very challenging, require a lot of self-discipline. That old statement has been made by many writers that writing is the hardest thing you'll ever do. I agree with that. It's really tough to say things clearly, precisely. But the demanding of it, the fact that it is so demanding to be clear, made my thinking have to be clear. And so that's what I try to do, you know, just get that stuff together. And it's an ongoing process, you know. I mean, it never stops. You especially when you see things that are surprising to you, which you always hope for. You go to a lot of shows, you very rarely see anything that's very surprising. But every once in a while you do, and it stops you and makes you reevaluate everything that you see, and that's kind of a great moment. The thing that I had to learn, I think in some way, that I'm still learning all the time, is that there are times to be critical and times to just shut up and work. It's really hard to both be an artist and a critic. And when you're in the studio, I mean, I had to learn this. This was one of the big problems I had in graduate school, is that you're getting so much criticism all the time that you jump toward the critical side in advance. As soon as you do something, you stand back and think, is that any good? No, it's never any good. But you just go on in spite of it. And you have to learn to turn that off as an artist. Just turn off your critical side so your intuition can just be at play. That's where your art comes from. Your art comes from your body. Your criticism comes from your head. Your head has to shut up. So one of the things you do as an artist is you develop strategies to get your brain to shut up. And one of them is just to work, just to go in and immediately start doing things. That took me a long time to learn. When I was in graduate school, I would spend so much time working a little bit and sitting and thinking and looking a lot. I don't waste my time thinking and looking anymore. It doesn't do any good. You just have to paint and let somebody else do the thinking.
I always thought if I had been a smoker, I would have been that kind of a painter. You know, I would see all this footage, you know, and I saw a lot of guys who spent a lot of time in front of their paintings with a cigarette. You know? Right. You always had that break or the length of the cigarette.
Yeah.
But
yeah, every artist has stories about that. I mean, Robert Irwin, the painter who's become more of a conceptual artist, he has great stories about just sitting and looking at his paintings, and he'd look so much he'd start to fall asleep and then wake up an hour later and just jolt himself into wakefulness and be staring again. And this would just happen every day in the studio. Became this kind of ongoing meditative nap time for him.
That's why I never wanted a comfortable chair.
So it became more and more reductive. He decided nothing was necessary. You know? And that there's no need for the paint. Even the painting was arbitrary. So he started just making things where a line on a painting would extend out around the walls, or that the line where the wall met the floor was as interesting as the line on the painting. So he thought, what if I eliminate the paint, the line on the painting, and just have the line on the floor? This led him into doing sort of environmental sculpture.
Right.
So anyway,
yeah,
that's what thinking can do. Make you crazy.
Get to nothing.
So. But I love painting, so I took the opposite approach. I just stopped thinking, not go the other way.
Well, I have a question now for Megan in terms of what were you able to draw out of this period in graduate school, once you had been so self-directed and brought your work into such a level of development independently, and then you suddenly were in the studio in that situation as a student, what kinds of demands were you used to making, and how did that meet your demands, and what were you able to draw from it?
Well, yeah, so grad school is a lot about thinking and about all these different ideas and how do you refine your idea and all your ideas and how you write your thesis about your work and all that. And I took that approach where I was just going to work, and all of that stuff kind of came secondary in a way. Like, I just needed to work because I saw it around me where everybody would get all this criticism and they would just stop working. And that seemed to be the biggest problem in grad school was people not doing the work, you know? And okay, you can conceptualize about it, you can sit there and talk about all your ideas all day, but how do you communicate those ideas? You know, if they're not written, if you're an art writer, great, okay, write it all down. But if you're an artist, a visual artist, and you're not working, which happened, then it's lost. Those ideas are lost. And so that was my approach, is I would come in 6 days a week and work in my studio and like shut it all out. and maybe the paintings weren't as conceptually tight as some people who were sitting there talking theory all day, but they didn't have anything to show. So it's like, okay, well, we can talk about this thing we see in front of us that you spent, you know, 3 months working on 6 days a week from, you know, 7 a.m. to whatever, 8 p.m. or whatever. Okay, we can talk about that and we can pick it apart and say it's whatever, terrible. And then these other people maybe just didn't have anything to talk about or to show, to talk. So that, I, you know, it was all about work for me. And that's been my approach for everything in life, really, is just like, you just gotta do it and get through it and learn from the work that you're making and learn from the mistakes that you make in that work and put it away. There's somebody in undergrad who told me that you're gonna make hundreds of bad paintings before you make one good one. It was like, okay. And it was true. And then and I also heard, like, you'll make one good painting out of 50 or one good painting out of 20. And as you practice more and as you paint more and as you push through these problem paintings, these things that don't work, those odds get better. And then you have like one good painting out of 5. Then you have 2 good paintings out of 5. Then, oh, maybe you have 1 bad painting out of 5. Okay, great. Now, you know, you keep working and you keep getting them to more concise ideas or more concise, better composition, better application, better, you know, everything. It gets better.
I want to share the mic with the audience in just a minute, but before I do, I have one question for the two of you, and that is, could you sort of give us some sense of what you would find as being really important and of great significance that you feel young artists would need, your students as they go out into the world, and I know how they transition from being there where they do have this this critical eye that they can either take on or shut off, you know? Something parting for...
Go ahead.
I think well, I see
really
the,
useful for you.
I see the students that I have right now. They and I think it's this generation that it's all about immediate gratification. You know, they can go on their phone, they can see whatever they want right now. They get all the answers. It's all there for them. It's and then when they're in the classroom, they want that also. They want to know exactly the answer. They want to know how to do it, how to get their ideas across. They want it immediately. You know,
And it's, I always am telling, you know, you just gotta work through it, like let it happen. You can't, I don't have the answer for your work. I can tell you how to apply the paint. I can tell you how to make something appear illusionistic on your two-dimensional plane, but I can't give you all the answers. And that's what they want. And so it's like, slow down. Like, this takes time. And that goes back to what I was just saying, like, at first you might make 100 paintings that are all bad, or 100 drawings that are all bad. You just gotta work through it and slow down. The answers aren't all there for you. You have to figure them out.
I'm not sure what I would say to a young artist now. I mean, the art world has changed so much. You know, one of the things about, I feel about my own life is that, as people say, timing is everything. And we became artists at a really good time. We were very lucky. I mean, when I was in undergraduate school, and graduate school is right the time when there started becoming a lot of art galleries in the big cities. There hadn't been galleries like that before. You know, they talk about the early days in San Francisco, the 50s or the 40s or 30s. There were no art galleries in the 50s. There were some art galleries, one or two. 60s, two or three or four. But then in the 70s, there became 20, 25, 35. And so right when I was getting out of graduate school, it was possible for me to have a show someplace. So timing, I would say be born at a good time. And now that's going the other way. Now they're closing, things are closing back down again. So this is a rough time. And that's part of it. I mean, it also, being an artist, being a painter, I don't know what to say about it. I mean, I love it. It's the greatest thing, but I couldn't recommend it to other people. I mean, I'm sort of a freak. And I think any artist is. You know, it's a monastic life. The thing that shocked me about being an artist was the loneliness of it. Nobody prepared me for that. I mean, you're in these undergraduate classes with all these other students, and you're having a good time. You can take coffee breaks whenever you want and think, this is great. What's not to like about this, you know? You're making art. You don't have homework. I mean, you don't have to go you don't have to go write. And you come to the studio at night and you paint. You think, oh yeah, just more recess. I like this. This is good. But then you get out of school and you think, wait, where did everybody go? I mean, you're all alone. It's not fun. And I don't have the money to just go take coffee breaks all the time. And I don't get anything done that way. So that's hard. That's a really hard thing. And I think it took me a long time. I don't know how I survived it in some ways. I mean, you know, like by the third year of loneliness, I started to get used to it, I think. And now I think it's great. Now I love it. But it wasn't like that at first. And you have to figure out a way to make a living, and you don't know what the hell you're doing as an artist, and nobody's interested in your work. And you just spend a lot of years just getting through that difficult early stage period. Would I pass that on to somebody else willfully? Not really. I mean, you have to have some talent, and you have to have great perseverance and just passion. You just have to love to do it. And there's just not many people that do, you know? So those people, they're gonna do it no matter what I say anyway. You know? And nobody else, there's nothing I can say to them either, you know? Can't make them do it.
So we'd love to bring you the mic if you have some questions. If there's some questions for Chris, Megan, anyone?
Oh, hi. I'm just curious to know if you think painters can be involved in social change in the way that, say, conceptual artists sort of think they can, and just how, what you think the artist's role or responsibility is in society. If that makes sense.
Go ahead, Megan.
Oh,
take
boy.
It.
I mean, I think painting is really important for changing how people perceive the world and how people see all these different ways of doing things. And I think this is part of teaching also is, you know, students coming into the classroom and seeing a broad approach for lots of different ways of doing the similar thing, and then applying that to a worldview, thinking about how there are so many different people in the world who are doing so many of the things that are the same, but they're doing them in all these different approaches, different ways of doing the same thing, and just giving that viewer or those students the kind of capacity to see diversity in that way, and that there are a multitude of ways of doing things that, you know, there's not just one right or wrong. I think that speaks to kind of how paint can change people, paintings can change people.
You know, I've been in a few discussions about this, like in groups like this, you know, where we have, you know, panel discussion talking about this issue of whether painting can contribute to social change. Almost always, I'm on the outside, I'm shouted down at the end. Because my answer basically is no, I don't think so. I'm not really interested in the ideas, the sociological ideas of most paintings. I mean, they're sort of like anecdotal to me. I think this about it. You know, there are a lot of problems in society, and I think they're really interesting, important problems. I think our election is a really interesting thing that goes on right now. Can I influence the election with a painting? I mean, you know, there's the Obama sticker that was made by, what's it, the Shepherd Fairey, that's well known, and maybe that's an example of something that's the way art moves into the public sphere politically in some way. But does it really have an effect? Does it change anything? I would say no. I mean, I think that artists can be intelligent people who can add to the conversation verbally. But almost all complex social or political questions in any society are fundamentally verbal questions. They're intellectual questions. They have to be answered verbally. Pictures, which are fundamentally cartoons in some way, are not going to influence a verbal argument. The questions are too complicated to be influenced by a single still picture. They can be influenced by film, they can be influenced by literature, but I don't think painting is the medium for that. If you want to do that, choose a medium that's appropriate to that. You know, be a filmmaker if you're visual. But I don't think painting should, I mean, I don't think you should be using painting with that goal in mind. It's like using a shovel to build a car. You know, it's the wrong tool. Painting is really great. I think it's really valuable, but it's great for other kinds of things and only for people that are really interested in looking. And that's the real truth. So.
This is a question for Chris. Would you say something about the painting behind you that you've done? I'd like to.
Sure.
Thank you.
Well, let's see. It's like one of the things I could say about it immediately, but if you have specific questions, I'd try to answer those. But this painting is like a number of paintings that I made, and it deals with this idea of opposition. It deals with order and chaos. And the relationship of order and chaos is kind of fundamental to my work. It's fundamental to maybe my life view in some way. That we go around in our lives trying to create a sense of order. It makes us feel comfortable. It gives us a sense of control. But the fact is that we don't order the world, the sense of the universe. The universe is handed to us and things happen by accident all the time. And our lives are made out of some sense of order and a great deal of accident that has just as much effect as any order we impose. And oftentimes, accidentally, the people that we meet and the things that we end up doing by mistake have as much influence, good influence on our lives as anything else we do. And this painting is kind of like that. It's about me walking down the street in some kind of ordered situation, and stuff happens, right? You think things, you see something, an event happens, and our mind is just filled with all these kinds of different ideas. And this painting kind of represents the way my mind works. It has these illusions of order, but shit happens, you know? And I kind of love it. It's what it's about. And it's what creates a sense of excitement in the painting, you know? The contrast, it's like trying to hold things together that don't go together. That's the nature of my life every day. You know, I feel like I'm just struggling to hold it together. And I try to just go with it, you know? And I make it a subject of my painting.
This is a pretty simple question for Megan. The short version is, what's your definition of cohesive? And I say that because in your telling of all the applications to art school, eventually it was a cohesive body of work. And my thought is, are art schools still doing that? Is the myth of consistency not yet broken? And is it the quality of the work or something that had value to you, or did you really have to present something with a kind of consistency that could be read and judged with that overlay, which would make me skeptical about art schools?
Yeah, I think that was what my perception of getting into grad school was about, was kind of a unified body of work that didn't have a bunch of different tangents, you know, that you could read as okay, you could walk into a gallery and see these paintings next to each other and sort of read a narrative, or maybe it wasn't a narrative, but you know, some sort of cohesion. I have departed from that idea, absolutely. Like, I do not think that I need to be, and I feel kind of guilty about this sometimes, or maybe not guilty, but sometimes when I present my work and I don't feel like it's, like, necessarily really visually cohesive or conceptually cohesive, like, maybe there are a few different sort of tangents or bodies of work. I feel completely comfortable doing that now because I don't feel like I need to do one thing that one idea in a bunch of different approaches, you know. I do that, I guess, to a certain extent where, you know, I have like these core beliefs and the paintings kind of come out of that. But yeah, I've had shows at places where the work hasn't been cohesive or you know, you could read it all as one person doing it, and I've had people come in and be like, is this a bunch of different people doing this? And I'm like, no, it's all my work, and I can talk about how they do have connections. You know, they're all, I made them all. That's the biggest connection. then I can talk about, you know, how that painting relates to that painting. They have a relationship. They're hung next to each other, and when you're looking at this painting, there is going to be a relationship with the one that's next to it, and that depends on the viewer a lot. In a big sense, it depends on what the paintings are telling you, I guess. does that kind of answer the? I don't know where I went. I started going off on a tangent.
You did. It was just more about the conceit of how there's still some sort of mythology. Uh-huh. That the very art schools who are, in theory, teaching our artists and
yeah.
Encouraging them are somehow limiting them
right.
with a certain conceit that I don't believe in.
Yeah.
I don't believe artists are typically consistent.
Yeah, I don't think so either.
They're all over the place.
Yeah.
But that the art world and dealers and curators are trying to tell a story.
Right, they want to get you into this box that we can understand as the viewers, because then it's easier for our consumption of the images. Like, okay, I totally get it, great. Like, I can leave now, instead of having this, like, these unknowns, these questions that I think is a beautiful thing about painting. It might lead to more questions. That's what a good painting should do, I think, is have the viewer question what's going on in the work, question what's going on in their lives in relation to that. And yeah, I think that that's a big problem, that it's, you know, we all want to understand it all. My students, you know, I have to direct I have my students writing artist statements, and that's supposed to, like, explain it all. But it's like, it doesn't explain it all. There are so many other things that the artist is doing, that the viewer is going to bring to it, that the artist doesn't know. You know, everybody has different things that they think when they go up and look at a painting, and different perceptions. So yeah, I completely agree with you.
I have a question about how would you communicate the value of art to the general public? I started thinking about this when I saw a study of, I think it was 17th century Dutch estates, and how the baker had 17 paintings, and the plumber had 25, and the professor had 120. And, you know, I think in a time like that, a young person growing up, whether your name is Rembrandt or somebody we never heard of, could reasonably expect to have a way of making a living as an artist. And then more recently, in San Jose, there was this story of, I think it was the ballet just going bankrupt because there wasn't enough money in Silicon Valley that was interested in the arts. And and then just this last weekend, I mean, this is all bubbling up now, I guess, in my head, but I was talking to a man who wants to create a website that will promote artists' work. And I said, well, what we really need is a way to communicate why somebody should invest in art and buy art and have art. It's not just to be nice to the starving artist and give them a little money, but what benefit is it to them to have art and live with art? If you could go on PBS and tell the world, or NBC or something, what would you say?
Yeah. Go ahead, Megan.
Go ahead.
Yeah, that's a big question. It's a hard question because, of course, an awful lot of people are not very interested in art. I mean, a lot of people are not that visual. There are many different art forms. Some people are interested in one form, not the others. But art, no matter what its form, whether we talk about music or the visual arts, anything else, is always an amazing thing. You know, it's the expression of our highest capabilities as a race, as a species of animal on this earth. And it's always incredible. It says art is so readable for, and I mean that sort of orally or visually, it's readable in so many different ways. In the same way that a person's voice is readable, we know what they mean, not simply by the words, but by the intonation. And art expresses so much, depending on how literate you are visually. You know, painting expresses so much that way. And the wonderful thing is it's accessible to a kindergartner or to someone who's been painting like Wayne Thiebaud for 95 years, you know, or at least he's 95 years old. And he reads more into paintings, sees more in paintings than anybody I've ever known, you know, and it's just kind of incredible to watch him look and to listen to him talk about what he sees, you know, and you learn so much from it. In that sense, you know, painting will never die, I don't think. I mean, it will go in and out of fashion as it always has. Art will go in and out of fashion. Music will, different kinds of music will, ballet, theater, all these things. But some form of will always be fascinating because it will tell us so much about the people who made it, what they thought, what they felt, what they believed in. And that's still true today. You know, our contemporary art says so much about who we are. It talks a lot about how we're a very highly evolved capitalistic society, for example. The scale of our paintings says a lot compared to the scale of paintings in other cultures. The subject matter of them, the slickness of them, the value of them, all these things say a lot about the style of our culture, which is very based economic in a very extreme economic model, you know. But that's just, that's maybe a temporary phenomenon. In any case, I think that I would say painting is always valuable because it represents the purest form of seeing. It's a representation of the way we see the world. And it's inflected by our, as I say, by our values, by the things we care about, and maybe even specific things about kind of literally how we see as opposed to the way people in other cultures see. In that sense, I mean, it's hard to make a great argument for it. You know, it's never going to be the most popular thing. But doing it itself, I think learning to do art, it's both an incredibly valuable activity for kids. I mean, kids, it helps develop their brains for kids to learn to do painting, to do sculpture, to make things with their hands. The relationship between the brain and the hands is a well-known phenomenon, you know? And in that sense, learning to make art is a great thing. It teaches you to make and to see, to use those relationships between your hands and your brain. And I think then learning to see as you get older, whether you make art or not, is always just a great, enriching experience.
I think that's a wonderful place to end right now at the Richmond Art Center, where we have 80 years of doing just that, with having art for children and adults, a place to work and experience that, to have our lives enriched, to be able to assemble wonderful art all around us, to have the support of these fabulous artists who are willing to come and share their work and their thoughts and their lives with us. And I thank you all for joining us today. We're going to take... Thank you, Chris. Thank you.